Now, I thought we might talk just a little bit about some of the psychological aspects.
Well, what is it?
Now, we all know, and we've talked a great deal about the physical aspects of alcoholism. We know that alcoholism is a true physical disease. Am I speaking loudly enough? Bill, can you hear back there? Yeah. Okay, Gene. And we know that. And I'd like to talk a little bit, on the other hand, about some of the psychological aspects of alcoholism. I don't know whether what I have to say makes any sense whatsoever. It certainly is not taken from any book. Now, as some of you know, I'm engaged in a surgical specialty, but my training was bilateral. I was also trained in psychiatry. Now, I don't practice psychiatry, and I never have practiced psychiatry in private practice. I could, but I don't. As someone once said when I came into AA, and they found out that I'd had some psychiatric background, they said, what's worse than a confused psychiatrist? But I am not. I am in a surgical specialty, but nonetheless, but I'm not going to talk about the textbook features of alcoholism. This you can read ad nauseum, you know. But I'd like to kind of talk just a little bit off the top of my head as to what seems to occur as I see it in my limited way. Now, it seems to me that the drunk, and perhaps all people for that matter, and I do hereby include all people, but let's limit it predominantly to the drunk, just for a minute. It seems to me that the drunk is born with an absolute direct pipeline to God. I think all children are, perhaps. I think certainly the drunk is. I'm often reminded each Christmas when I see the Cosmopolitan magazine, it shows a delightful, beautiful child, a girl, usually, dressed in winter clothes, and she's not looking directly at you from the cover, but she's looking off at something. And you're certain that she sees something. It's right there. And you almost wish you could get inside that picture and look around to see what she sees. I think the drunk is born with this. I think he's born with an absolute, he sees something. Maybe all people do, in a sense. And he's filled full of the joy of something. He's filled full of the joy of something. And one day, he comes in to his mother. Now, when I say mother, I don't mean a specific woman, or even a woman, necessarily. I mean the mothering one. I mean life itself. Maybe the community, maybe the family, but those who are so significant to you and to me and to all of us as we grow up somewhere. And in this culture, which is, I suppose, the best of all cultures, it seems that there is some difficulty in the mutual giving and receiving of tenderness. This is difficult to do, you know. So this little child, the drunk-to-be, comes into his mother, or the mothering one, or to life, and it says, mother, or life, or love, the mothering one, it says, I love you. And life, or the mothering one, or mother, or father, whoever it is, has a little difficulty accepting this, because it makes him feel uncomfortable, and he looks at the delightful child who has a direct pipeline to God, and it's filled full so much, and says to the child, have you done the dishes yet? And the little one says to itself, no, I haven't done the dishes yet, but what in God's name happened to my statement? And it ponders this. And then one day, it goes out and it continually sees the pipeline to a something, a faith and a belief in something. And then one day it comes into the mothering one and to life itself, and it says to this individual or individuals, I just learned how to skate. And life or the mothering one says, be careful you don't fall down. Well, you know, this brings it aside. But what happened to my enthusiasm? What happened to my statement? And the little child ponders this and goes outside and looks up, and that pipeline is fractured. And it doesn't see it quite so clearly. And then it comes back in, and this happens repetitively over the course of time, it seems to me, and this may be wrong, you can accept this or not, it doesn't make any difference. And it comes in finally to life or the mothering one again, and it wants to say, I love you, I need you, hold me, let me hold you, but it remembers that you might have to go wash the dishes. Or it remembers that, be careful you don't fall down. And this angers it. And so it says to life or the mothering one, I don't like you, and it gets a clip on the side of the face and says, you don't talk to me that way. Well, the little one goes outside, and that pipeline is gone. It no longer exists, and the child looks and looks and looks, and it's gone. And what it saw is no longer there, and it feels a sense of confusion, and it feels a sense of being nowhere, and then it says to itself, something's happened. At this instant, it seems to me, the drunk dies. The drunk is dead at this point. You know, I often think about these resentments that we talk about in Alcoholics Anonymous. You know, I don't think that the resentment towards one's family, towards one's boss, towards one's job, these are kind of incidental, it seems to me. It seems to me that in many of the drunks, the thing that's being carried is a resentment towards the fact that it's even alive, that it was even indeed born somewhere, that this gnaws at the drunk to be, the drunk to be. And so I said, what do you do? What do you do? You can't say, I love you. You can't say, with enthusiasm, I learned how to skate. You can't say, I don't like you. What do you do? And it does. But then it builds in this death a way of dealing with people, and it talks to people in terms of supposed to be. And it talks to people in terms of, I will say please, I will say thank you, because it's kind of expected. Anything that'll somehow maintain me as I go amongst people. Now, there's great benefit in saying thank you.